Good evening.
Good evening.
Hey, we want to welcome everyone to Lighthouse Church. We are excited to share the greatest story, I think, that's ever been told. How many of you are ready for just an amazing evening? Now, what was really cool about this morning is we had four people invite Jesus into their heart.
Yeah!
We had about 16 others kind of recommit. They just said, you know, I've just not been doing what I need to be doing. And so the reason we do this program every year is we want to share the greatest story ever told. But the most important thing is we want you to know that there's a God out there who is crazy about us, a God that created us, a God that loves us, a God that sent his son, his only son, to die on the cross for you and for me.
Amen. Glory.
And I say all that because this is really like a personal love note written specifically for you. The fact that you're here tonight is not by accident. Your name was written in the seat before you got here. And there's a personal love note written to you saying, I'm crazy about you. Look what I've done so that you can be made right and that you can be just in open communication with me and with the Father. So that's really what tonight's all about. We want to encourage you to become part of the program. In other words, there's going to be times where we're going to get real excited and we want you to get real excited. There's going to be times where you're hearing people yell. We want you to be free to yell. There's going to be times where we're singing and we want you to sing. We want you to be part of this story. So if you could imagine going back to a little over 2,000 years ago to what it would have been like the day that Christ rode in on a donkey, what it would have been like that Palm Sunday, that's where we want you to be. I'm going to open us in prayer, and then we're going to start this this program and let it speak for itself. Would you bow your heads? Dear Heavenly Father, we're here because you wanted us to be here tonight. And we're excited to see the love that you have for each and every one of us. And we're thankful that you've called us to be right here. So Lord, I just pray that you open our hearts to receive the greatest message ever told. I pray that it connects and that we're hearing what you want us to hear tonight. And we give you all the praise. We give you all the glory. In Jesus' name.
Arrest him!
Mother of Jesus, and I'm going to tell you a story about my son. Now, some of you have probably already heard this story, since he is pretty famous, but with good reason. And I'm not just a mother bragging about her child. I'm going to tell you what really happened. So listen closely, and you'll hear the greatest story of all time. You see, Jesus had been healing people all throughout Israel. He gave sight to the blind, hearing to the deaf, speech to the mute, and wholeness to the lame. He cast out demons and called for repentance. But his restoration was angering some of the religious leaders in Jerusalem, people who didn't want Jesus as their king. This made it even more dangerous when my son and his 12 disciples decided to go into Jerusalem on that very first Palm Sunday many, many years ago. People were shouting, naming him the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Look, here he comes now. Let's praise him and prepare the way as Jesus comes into Jerusalem.
Thank you.
There's kids coming.
No. No, he didn't have time. He didn't remember, guys. Come back some other time.
Praise to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, our God and our King. To Him we will sing. In His great mercy He has given us life, that we can be called the children of God. Great is the love that the Father has given us. He has delivered us. He has delivered us. Children of God, sing your song and rejoice for the love that He has given us all.
She's an adulteress. She's demonic.
Despicable. What a train. Why does she think we like her?
She's hideous.
What a joke.
She's a Jezebel. Stoner. Look at her.
She's nasty. She's a tramp.
Everyone knows who I was. 7 demons, people would whisper. Mary Magdalene is possessed of 7 demons. You have no idea what I've been through. The lies and rumors. I'm so ashamed of the person I used to be. I'm filled with so much guilt. I just want to be free.
So
From that day on, all I had to do was call on Jesus. My son showed love to so many people. I don't know if you've heard this story, but he once fed 5,000 people with only 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. They were hungry, and he met their needs. He brought people back from the dead, and he healed diseases. And although he was my child, I know he was the Son of God. His power made this clear, and it was angering some of the religious leaders in Jerusalem. One man in particular was upset by Jesus' power. His name was Caiaphas, and he was a high priest in the temple of Jerusalem. You see, Jesus had condemned Caiaphas and the other leaders for ruining Israel by focusing more on making money than on serving God. So Caiaphas tried to find a way to stop my son. He talked to one of Jesus' disciples, Judas. This was somebody we all thought was my son's friend. But he agreed to betray my son for 30 pieces of silver. He gave up my son for money. He led a group of soldiers into the Garden of Gethsemane. He cried out to Jesus as if he were his master and greeted him as a friend. But he only did this to identify him to the soldiers. Jesus was arrested and carried away. My son's disciples, his closest friends, were terrified, and they scattered. Let me introduce you to a couple of his friends that were there. Here comes Peter and John now.
My name, just mention the name Peter, and everyone knows I denied you. Oh, how bold and confident I was. Lord, I will go with thee to prison, even death. But you know, Jesus knew me a lot better than I knew myself. He knew the spirit was willing, but the flesh was so very, very weak. Now, if it would have come down to a fight, I could have wielded my sword just as well as anyone. Remember, I'm the one that cut the ear off the high priest's servant. But to stand there and listen to these trumped up charges and false statements, I felt like it was a lost cause. Here was my master, whom I had been with for the past 3 years. There's no doubt in my mind he is the Messiah. He is the anointed one. Standing before his accusers like a meek lamb. Don't you understand? They were calling for his crucifixion. I knew I could be next. I could stand up to the soldiers in the garden, but I couldn't stand up to a lady on the balcony. All she said was, "Aren't you one of his disciples?" Well, I didn't want anything to do with it. So I denied him, not one time, but 3 times. He was willing to die for me, and I wanted nothing to do with him. And then I heard the rooster crow for the second time. I recalled the warning that Jesus had just given me hours before. Jesus said, "This day, this night, you will deny me 3 times. I can't believe I did that. It just seemed like just a few minutes ago that I was in the garden with Jesus and he was praying.
I admit it. At first I fled. John, beloved apostle, probably one of the closest of all the disciples to our Lord. Yet I fled in fear. A crowd of men had come to the garden with swords, spears, lanterns, and torches. I watched in horrified astonishment as Judas betrayed our master with a kiss. I saw the soldiers fall to the ground at Jesus' divine presence and the power of his words. And when asked if he were indeed the Christ, he simply said,
"I am."
Arrest him.
You stay away.
What are you doing?
Get up.
I stood by, confused, dazed, frightened, as they bound the hands of my Lord and led him away. Then I ran.
Charges are you bringing against this man?
This man is a criminal. Were it not so, we would not have brought him.
Then take him away and judge him by your own religious laws.
We have no power to execute him.
Are you the king? Are you the king of the Jews?
You say I'm the king, but in fact, the reason I was born was to tell the truth.
Crucify him!
I've no reason to charge this man.
Crucify him!
I find no reason to charge this man. But, guards, it is your custom. Every year at Passover, I release one prisoner. Would you have me release this innocent man?
Crucify him!
You would rather have Barabbas.
We want Barabbas!
Barabbas, this man has caused such an uprising.
Bring Barabbas!
If you want this man executed, his blood is on you.
Thank you. Thank you.
died on a cross on a hill called Calvary. I watched my son killed by a broken world in order to save it. My son's love demands a response from all of us. If you would have been in the scene, if you would have been at Calvary, which role would you have played? Would you have been like John and Mary Magdalene? People who truly believed that Jesus was the Son of living God. People who continued to trust in him through his suffering and gave him their hearts and devotion. Would you be like Peter? Would you abandon Jesus if following him were too difficult or scary? Are you like Judas? Do you claim to be a friend of Jesus, but betray him with your actions? Maybe you're even like Caiaphas, someone who believes that they are perfect, someone who doesn't need to change or doesn't need a savior. But the truth is, we all need a savior. Every single one of us is a sinner, and we need the repentance and redemption that Jesus brings. You see, no matter your past or your present, he loves you anyway.
More than my strength to see me still. Exhaling in every breath the blighting brings. To the grave he
gain victory, triumphing over life with the fear of endless sleep. Endlessly we hide from our mortality. Mortally wounded from birth, we lie to ourselves from infancy. Infinitely investing time in a life that will inevitably be taken by this incredible creature that now stands before me. Death. He manifests himself on ordinary days. His 6-foot stomach growls with hunger pangs. For his meal, he cannot wait, so we are forced to taste him even before the grave. We are all dying. There is no other way. I see him in Haitian and Japanese earthquakes. He's hating the escapees of his cruel wakes. I see him in poverty, impoverishing the quality of life for regions that are reachable, and in those with the reach who find reason not to reach out to treat what is treatable. I see him in disease, taking life out of uninfected yet affected families. I see him in oppression, pressing down on the oppressed and the oppressor. I see him in depression, in Prozac and painkillers, razor blades and bedside pills. I see him in abuse, physical, mental, emotional misuse. I see him in spiritual confusion, material obsession, physical possessions. I see him in marital transgressions, childhood remorse from an ugly divorce. I see him in our slavery to appearances, appearing to care more about our images than those in dying villages. I see him in our ignorance, ignoring truth with some comfortable inference. I see his emergence in our churches as we pull out emergency verses as deterrents to religious differences, going on the defensive, defending our way of worship, making community worthless. Death is killing us before we even enter the surface of the earth. We are in service of his words. It is finished. The end of our curse. We cannot hide from his wretched curse. For death and his grave, we constantly rehearse. Even God himself was coerced. Divinity immersed itself in humanity, humbly taking on flesh, scorning vanity. The world saw his way of life as insanity, insisting he cease speaking of this radical Christianity. But man found him guilty, accusing God of blasphemy, performing the ultimate usurpation by slaying Christ on Calvary. But through their cowardly cross, Jesus embossed mankind with amnesty, championing over death and the beauty of his fatal injury. And I know, many still doubt, and rightfully so, bringing up this inquiry. What does that poor Jewish man, dying on a Roman tree 2,000 years ago, have to do with me? I reply simply, Christ came and died to marry his bride-to-be. Death could kill the groom, it could not kill the ring. God made us one with Christ and life, and natural is clean. Now the undying church, his ever-living wife, can sing. Oh death, where is your sting? Oh grave, where is your victory? For we have risen above your misery. We will not succumb to your finality. So at this time, I'm going to ask that everyone just bow their heads, close their eyes for just a second. The love that the Father has for us is simply amazing. The fact that Jesus would come and willingly give his life so that we could be made right is amazing. The fact that even though sometimes our lives are messed up and we've done some things that we're not proud of and he loves us anyway is amazing. We do this program each year, we do it for one reason. And that's to make sure that every single person that comes in here has an opportunity to know what Jesus did, but also has an opportunity to respond. So what I want to do for you is I want to give you an opportunity to respond. If you're new tonight, or if you have never invited Jesus into your heart, like this is really new to you, or maybe you've heard about it, but you've never really experienced, you didn't know what he really did for you. If you're new and you want to invite Jesus into your heart, then I'm going to just have you raise your hand just for a second. Okay. You can put your hands down. Now I want to ask those who, for whatever reason, maybe you once knew Jesus and you were walking side by side with him and everything was going great. In fact, it was going so great that you just decided to start doing things your way. Because that's what happens oftentimes when things are going really good. We start to do things our way, and the next thing you know, we start to get busy. And the next thing you know, our life is spinning out of control and it's a mess and we don't know how we ended up there. But the one thing that we do know is we've not been where Jesus wants us to be. In fact, we find that we're back in the same place that we were before we invited him into our heart the first time. So if that's you, and you know tonight that you're not where you should be, I want to ask you to raise your hand just for a second. Just raise it up and then you can put it back down. Amen. You can put your hands down. So what we want to do is, as we close this out is I want to give you an opportunity to be made right. And here's the really, really cool thing. If you've seen anything tonight, know this. Jesus did it all.
Amen.
That's the good news. Jesus did it all, and all you have to do is accept that. And so if you want to be made right tonight, and you want to be able to walk out of here just knowing, being fully confident and fully sure that you are right with God, which is really cool, because ultimately, whether we know this or not, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. The question is will we do it willingly? But one day, we're all going to battle. So tonight, you have a chance of leaving knowing that if anything would ever happen, you get to spend eternity with a God who, from day one, has always been crazy about you. So if that's you tonight, I just want to ask you to repeat after me. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for loving me, messed up me, broken me, ashamed me, sinful me. Thank you for sending your Son to die on the cross for me. I admit that my way doesn't work. I admit that I need a Savior. And it's evident tonight that His name is Jesus. So tonight I choose willingly to follow Him and make Him Lord of my life in Jesus' name. Everyone said, amen. God is good. Yeah, I want to challenge you. If you made that commitment tonight, that's only a first step. And we're really big about next steps here. In other words, we don't believe that you just come forward and you invite Jesus into your heart and that's it. That's really cool and that's exciting. And when that happens, check this out. The angels are celebrating. I believe there's a celebration taking place right now. Celebration taking place, but that's only the first step, because the very next thing that you need to do is you need to get baptized. In other words, you need to go forward and publicly confess to your friends and family that Jesus is Lord of your life. You need to go public with your faith. And here's a really cool thing. Whether you attend this church or not, the week after Easter, we're having another baptism service. We've got about 10 people. Now, we've had 18 baptisms in about 6 weeks, and so 10 more in 2 more weeks, and maybe after tonight, even more. We're really excited about that.
Yeah!
But baptism isn't it either. Because, again, we're a church that there's next steps. And so one of the things that we're going to be talking a lot about in our church over the next several weeks is we're going to be talking about the Word of God. Because we believe that there is power in the Word of God.
Yes.
And so once you've invited Jesus into your heart, and once you've been baptized, the very next thing we want to do is we want to get you a Bible. And so if there is anyone here who does not have a Bible, before you leave tonight, we would love to be able to give you one. Want to make sure that you have that opportunity to open up. And the really cool thing is everything you just saw, to the best of our ability, to the best of our knowledge, is in there. You can go back and you can reread and hear about a God that loves us so much. In fact, the really cool thing about the Bible is it is all about Him doing everything possible to bring us back to Him. So with that being said, I just want to thank you so much for coming out and being a part of this. We're going to play one last song. And about halfway through the song, we're going to stop for just a moment, and we're going to allow everyone here to take pictures, because we don't like pictures, right? And then we'll dismiss. So if everyone would remain seated for just a second, we're going to play this last song, and then we'll dismiss.
God's not dead!
Let hope arise and make Let's